My name is John Thompson. I have the honor and the privilege to be the European Regional Coordinator for the Future Agricultures Consortium. I'm also a fellow at the Institute of Development Studies. And I'm delighted to see such a wonderful turnout for this London Policy Dialogue event. This is a reflection of work that we've been doing over the last several years, engaging with agricultural policy processes across a number of themes, and I'll introduce some of those themes to you in the course of my short overview, and give you a little bit of background also on the work of Future Agricultures, our approach, what we think makes us distinctive in the world of agricultural policy research. Then we're going to go, after I give my introduction, into a series of presentations, thematic presentations, on different areas of work that we've been pursuing over the last year or two, and in some cases beyond that, with some plenary sessions to allow some questions and answers, not only from the audience here, but we understand via the internet as well, which is one of the reasons we're sitting here, and rather than standing to address you, we're being filmed and that's being broadcast, so we have to sit in one place and not move too much as we're speaking, which is unfortunate for me. I prefer to stand as I talk, but so it goes. So let me get into it, because we have a lot to cover, and I'll just give you a little bit of background to begin with on Future Agricultures, talking a little bit about its origins and its focus, describing some of the partners and the places we're working, talking a bit about our communications and engagement activities, this being one of many that we're involved in, why we think it's important then to think about the political economy of agricultural policy, to bring in that policy processes perspective to work in this area, which we think is sadly lacking in a lot of the work that we see out there. Highlight briefly then the main themes that we're working in across the region, and talk a little bit about a small number of those. This event was also advertising work that we're doing at not just a country level, but at a regional scale, and engaging with broader regional processes, such as the African Union's Comprehensive Africa Agriculture Development Program and the G8's New Alliance Initiative, and taking a constructively critical look at some of that work that we'll be talking about today. And then I'll talk briefly about the program, the aim of the day, and then about the launch event that we're going to have at the end. Now, we've been supported since 2005. That was the origins, with the assistance of the UK Department for International Development. And they've been very generous in their support and very hands-off, shall we say, in the kinds of relationship we've had. They've allowed us with our partners to really set out an agenda and allow that to emerge, evolve over time. But the focus initially was about encouraging good dialogue, good debate on these ag policy issues, and to share some of those lessons about good practice with policymakers, other opinion leaders in Africa on the role of agriculture in broad-based growth and development. Now, why Future Agricultures? The main reason is because we've felt and continue to feel that there's been a lack of attention on these political economy questions, and that's led to a certain amount of inappropriate policy formulation and weak implementation failures in the sector that continue to plague some of the agricultural activities in the region. However, as Steve will talk about shortly, we've also seen some changes, some improvements, and some positive trends, which we want to highlight as well. When we emerged, we started focusing, it was originally three founding institutions in the UK, Imperial College Y, that then moved to SOAS, the team there at the School of Oriental and African Studies, the Overseas Development Institute, our hosts here, and Institute of Development Studies in Sussex. Over time, however, we've grown, and we've worked with partners in three countries, in Malawi, Kenya, and Ethiopia, on a small number of themes. But since that time, we've grown quite substantially in terms of the numbers of members in Africa, both senior and junior researchers, and the number of partners that we're collaborating with, not only in the UK, but other parts of the EU, and now with emerging powers, with colleagues in Brazil, in China, and soon India. And we've also established a fairly credible communications alliance, a partnership with a set of communications professionals that has allowed us to reach out and inform and engage with a number of debates. We've also sought to engage with the African Union at that level of regional planning and policy making through CADEP, through a whole set of other regional mechanisms, which we'll talk about through the course of the day. Over time, we've started to move our secretariat and our coordination activities out from the UK to what we're calling regional hubs. And we're working with partners in Ghana at the University of Ghana, the Institute of Statistical Social Economic Research there, Tegemeo Institute of Agricultural Policy and Development in Kenya, and PLOS at the University of the Western Cape in South Africa, that are now coordinating more of our engagement and research activities in the region. And we've slowly grown from those three countries to spread our activities across a number of regions, countries in East, Southern, and West Africa. Still a lot of the continent still to be touched, but we're relatively modest in our size in terms of overall budget, and we think we're doing reasonably well now with the coverage we've had. As I mentioned, our communications activities have been quite substantial. We've been a fairly productive partnership, over 150 publications available on our website. The sticks that you've all received have a lot of our policy briefs on them, and there's more to come that will be posted for free downloading on the website, as well as working papers and a range of other documents. This afternoon, we're going to be launching a new book and a new special issue of the Development Policy Review that based on Future Agriculture's work, and there's more of that, as I say, in the pipeline. We've also convened quite a number of high-level events over the last so many years. Most recently, two events, one on the green economy in the South, another on agricultural investment, gender, and land in Africa this year. And we've done, as you see, quite a number of others in the last few years. Now, thinking back to our origins and our focus, our focus is on agricultural policy and policy processes in Africa. As a concept, policy is a bit difficult to pin down. As one commentator five decades ago said, policy is rather like an elephant. You know it when you see it, but you can't easily define it. And I think that's still the case today in certain contexts. We see with the conventional view of policy processes that it's often defined as a series of rational steps, very clearly laid out steps that you see there. I won't go through them all. But it's often seen in a rather linear fashion in that regard, and that is a rational process seen as a rather bureaucratic approach. And in that approach is a separation of what you could describe as value and interests and agendas from fact or facts and the broad technical aspects of that. And that political nature, therefore, gets hidden by the use of that technical language. We use the term expression evidence-based policymaking a lot these days, and there's an assumption that you can generate good evidence, bring it to the attention of policymakers, and they're going to be enlightened as a result of that process and make a rational decision through that. Our experience is, and we argue, that that isn't the case at all, that policy, in fact, is very much a political phenomena, a set of processes, and that we need to see that policy is very much about power. And a quote here, policies appear to be instruments for promoting efficiency and effectiveness, but this masks the political under the cloak of neutrality, and that's a feature of modern power. And that's certainly the way we're approaching the research that we're doing, to understand the politics, the power behind those policy processes, the winners and the losers, who's driving certain agendas, who's winning, who's losing as a consequence. So why a policy process approach? One commentator said, well, what is a political economist? Someone who comes and explains why your program hasn't worked. And I think we're pretty good at that in future agricultures. We can explain why things aren't working so well or aren't working so well to the benefit of certain people, particularly poor and marginal rural people. However, we think, in our experience, having done this for the better part of 9 going on 10 years, that this kind of policy process type of analysis can actually identify and explain what is both technically viable and politically feasible, where you can find room to maneuver, where some good things can happen, where you can open up policy space that can lead to new opportunities, new innovations, and those innovations and opportunities can benefit poor and marginal groups in the settings in which we're operating. So we've created, DFID this year has undertaken a retrospective evaluation of our work over the last 7 or so years. And Martin Whiteside, welcome, who's the lead evaluator of that process, will be reporting on that next month at DFID. We're not in the position at this point to tell you the results of that, but we were, as part of that process, we created a theory of change that we retrospectively used for assessing how we've been performing. And in reflecting on that, we realized that this approach has been to try to inform policy processes and engage with these agendas on a number of different, in a number of different areas, around agenda setting, around shifts in policy framing, around changes in the way resources are allocated, and change in the actual content of policy, and in the way that's then delivered, the way it's implemented. And we've sought different entry points into these different thematic areas to try to inform and influence those agendas in those ways. And we'll talk more about what came out of those processes in the course of today. I mentioned that we've grown from a modest number of themes and partners. We're now working across 10 themes, which is a bit of a challenge at times in multiple countries in those themes. They're listed there. But all of those themes, as I say, bring that political economy lens. We're trying to understand how politics shapes those processes, looking at which policies get implemented in different contexts and why, and who decides, what political incentives are driving or constraining the implementation of pro-poor, pro-smallholder policy, why might a particular policy lead to differential outcomes in different contexts and for different peoples. So those are the sorts of overarching questions and lenses that we're using in the analyses of all those themes. Today, we're not going to cover all 10 themes, but we're going to highlight, draw some examples from 7 of those listed there. They're in your program. And we'll be allowing you to dig in with us into some of the results, some of the implications of those areas. So today, we're going to be also making reference, as we do that, to some of those broader regional processes that are shaping agendas on the ground. The one I mentioned already, CADEP, which is the African Union's framework for trying to achieve the elimination of hunger. That was launched in 2003, but recently reinforced in the Malabo Declaration this year, reaffirming a commitment to get governments. So this is public policy to devote 10% of national budgets to their agricultural development activities with the aim of using those policy reforms and processes to end hunger and cut poverty in half by 2015. The G8, working with the African Union and a set of private sector actors, has launched its new alliance for food security and nutrition in 2012. That's created quite a lot of interest, mobilized a certain amount of capital, and also seen quite a lot of opposition and critical comment about what are the real intentions of these private actors, who's going to benefit again. And DFID has asked us to take a look at that. And so today, in some of the presentations, we'll be making reference to the new alliance through the lens of the future agriculture's work. This also has an aim to reduce poverty. Their goal is 50 million people over the next decade by increasing that private investment. So it's seen as a complement to CADEP. However, there are clear tensions, which we might talk about today, between the CADEP AU-driven agenda and the new alliance private G8-driven agenda. Just to highlight briefly where CADEP is at the moment, it's probably somewhat difficult for some of you to see on these screens, but this is the results framework which is being developed now for tracking CADEP performance over the next decade. Following Malabo and the discussions that have been happening this year, there's now a projection for the year decade ahead. It's not enough to say we're making these commitments, but what difference are we making? Can we look at whether we're making a true impact at different levels? In the lower level, level three, where it's talking about transformational change as a result of CADEP, conducive environments, systemic capacity, those different areas highlighted in red are the areas that Future Agricultures is engaging with about improved and inclusive policy design, more efficient, stronger institutions, inclusive evidence and more inclusive and evidence-based agricultural planning, and so on. And so it's that level three that we're now having some engagement with on a number of themes that we'll be reporting on during the course of today. Now, looking to the program for the day, our aim here, as I said, is to present some of the findings that have been emerging from this thematic work, some of the key policy insights that those are generating that can inform some of the debates about CADEP, about the new alliance, and a number of other regional processes we'll be talking about. So to start things off, we've asked Steve Wiggins, one of the founders of Future Agricultures and a keen analyst of some of the broader trends in agricultural growth and investment, to give us an overview of where things are at the moment, some of the changing patterns and perspectives that we're seeing out there in different parts of the region. To set the scene, to give us some context, some points of reference to talk about through the course of the day. Then we'll have a plenary discussion following Steve's presentation and a short coffee break. That will then be followed by two presentations drawing extensively from our thematic work. It says Blessing Chinsinga and Colin Poulton. Sadly, Blessings can't be with us today due to a family loss. And Jim Sundberg, who was to speak with Steve, too, was unwell today and won't be able to join us. But fortunately, Colin Poulton from the School of Oriental and African Studies will be presenting work on CADEP success stories using that political economy lens to understand it. Then Ruth Hall from PLAS will, and our theme convener for the land theme, will be bringing some perspectives on large-scale land acquisitions and responsible investment in land in Africa, work that has been done over the last several years and continues to be extremely relevant in a number of key debates. There's going to be a large event in November that AU is organizing that will be addressing this question, so it's a timely presentation. We'll then have another plenary discussion followed by lunch. And in the afternoon, we're going to split this room into two, and we're going to have parallel sessions because we're not going to have enough time to cover all of these themes. The one parallel session will be dealing with water and seeds, with irrigation performance, and with the seed sector development in Africa. And the other will deal with pastoralism and livestock marketing, and with the emerging powers, with Brazil and China, and their effect on agricultural technology development and policy in the African context. The names are there. I won't have time to introduce everyone, but we'll do that in the afternoon sessions. Then there'll be another set of plenary question and answer and a coffee break. And at the end of the day, we hope you'll stay with us because we're going to launch some of those new outputs that I mentioned and offer some drinks for a more casual reception to talk with everyone here. So thank you for coming. I'm going to hand over to Steve, and he can move to the next presentation.